Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Iron Hound by Tim Akers. Narrated by Kyle McCarley. 1. Lost Causes. Chapter 1. They fell like a pair of suns, black and amber. Their tails curled with smoke and the burning cinders of autumn leaves. Their fall tore a wound in the sky and in the world itself. The impact shivered the trees with a wall of air that thundered down the valley, whipping branches and stone and earth. The river that bounded the witch's hallow hissed with steam and frost, and the stones that formed a dozen hinges scattered throughout the forest rang like bells beneath the hammer. Where they struck, their landing left a deep gash in the ground. Gwen Adair climbed out of the trench. Her hair was a wild mass of orange light, with sparks of red and black shimmering throughout, and her skin flickered gold and amber. She dragged a black mass behind her. Its talons dug at the earth, scraping wounds in the grass that bled shadow. The creature screeched in frustration. Gwen turned and gave it a solid kick. "Shut up," she hissed. "You've caused enough trouble. Just shut up for a moment so I can think." The Geist responded with a growl.
"I am not your tame dog, mortal. I am the grave, the sunset, winter's fury, and summer's fear. All mortal life ends in my embrace, just as day ends in night. I will never..."
"Shut up!"
Gwen howled. She bent her will toward the Geist, summoning the power of the Fen God coursing through her blood to send a wave of glittering light into the mass of shadows at her heel. The Geist shivered in pain, squealing as sparks of glowing energy danced through its bones. Gwen withdrew the lash, and the demon's cries subsided. It settled down, collapsing into a slowly swirling darkness, the bright tips of its claws clicking quietly together. An eye, slate gray and endless, blinked open.
"You cannot hold us forever, Iron Girl,"
it whispered. Its voice was like a whetstone, sharpening the air.
"Already I feel you dying. Whatever you have become, whatever understanding you have with Fomhara, I will be free once again."
"We'll see,"
Gwen muttered. The name was unfamiliar to her, though the spirit in her bones thrilled at the word. She gave the Geist another kick and started dragging it forward once again. The broken hill at the center of the hollow loomed in front of her, its peak a ruin of stone and torn sod. Her feet dug into the grass as she pulled the Geist uphill. There was something else holding her back. The god bound in her heart recognized this place and did not want to return. She didn't blame it. The witch's hallow had served as its prison, or sanctuary, or tomb, for generations. Silent centuries spent in darkness. She could feel its isolation in her blood. Gwen reached the crevasse that led into the hill and paused. Sunlight drifted peacefully into the tomb. The body of one of the Inquisitors lay halfway down, his skin dry and leathery, his life consumed by the power of the gods awakening. There was no sign of the others. From her perch, Gwen was able to see the distant shimmering of the river and the blooming fields of flowers that marked the final resting spot of the Hallow's guardians. Something moved among the trees. A herd of creatures very much like deer, only made of wicker and stone. They pranced nervously among the shadows. The scattered hinges, once used to focus the wards that protected this place, lay abandoned. The Hallow was a ruin. Its power fled. Hopefully, there was enough of its ancient force left to perform one final task. She started down into the tomb. The Deathgeist gave one last mighty struggle, wings flapping and talons scrabbling at the stone, its voice silent in the effort. Gwen dragged it under, and as soon as they landed among the scattered stones of the Fen God's cairn, the Deathgeist collapsed into silence. Gwen dusted her hands, purely a habit, as her sunbright skin seemed impervious to dirt, and looked around. A lot had changed, and yet nothing. Here, the Fen God was once buried. Here, the pillar that held its spirit cracked like an egg, Gwen's blood-wrought dagger still embedded in its heart. The smooth stones of the cairn lay tumbled around the sanctuary. The air smelled like dry leaves and wet roots. The crystals that had illuminated the tomb flickered dimly in the sunlight.
"So this is your plan,"
the Geist whispered as she released her grip.
"Bury me as they buried Fomhara. Hide me away from mortal eyes, that my power might be contained."
The demon curled in the dark corner, eyes and claws glinting in the bare light.
"It did not work before. It will not work now, especially with your house fallen."
"I'm not a fool," Gwen said. "The Witch's Hollow was only able to shelter the Fen God because of the Wardens.
Now the Wardens are all dead."
"You could replace them,"
the Geist said.
"You could become my true guardian and stand eternal watch at my tomb. Your family served that role. You could assume it. Become the true guardian of the pagan watch."
"Given eternity, I'm sure you'd find some way to trick your way to freedom," Gwen answered. "Hells, given eternity, I might let you go just to get some peace from your damned whispering." "No, that would never do."
"Then what? Will you raise an army of pagans to hold me here? Negotiate with Heartsbridge to imprison me? Surely the Inquisition can't be trusted again."
The Geist slithered away, the coiled strands of shadow that formed its body tightening into a fist.
"Face it, Huntress. You have no plan and no hope. Release me and spare yourself the corruption I will bring."
"I don't have a plan.
Yet," she allowed, strolling to the cairn and starting to arrange the stones.
"But I figure there's enough power here to hold you for a while. And in the meantime, I can come up with something. Or someone will."
"You really..." The Geist struck her from behind. A swirling cloud of shadow-tipped claws spun out of the boiling mass of its form, clattering off the stones before cutting into Gwen's back. Black wounds appeared across her body. She fell forward, skimming her hands so that they bled on the stones.
"You are as soft as all the children of blood,"
the geist hissed. It rose, its snapping tendrils looming against the hollow shell of the hill.
"So wise, so clever, so bright. But you all die eventually. You all come to me, no matter how fast you run."
"You will find more than blood in my veins," Gwen answered.
She pushed herself up, her hands slipping on the blood-slick rock. She turned slowly, drawing the autumn geist around her like a cloak. Her eyes turned to gold, and a mantle of sunbright leaves settled across her shoulders, turning her skin the color of beaten copper. The dark wounds filled with glowing light. The darkness leached away, spattering to the floor like burning pitch.
"I will let others run," she said. "I mean to stand against you."
"Stand and fall. Run and fall," the geist said, slate-gray eyes narrowing into slits. "It matters not."
They crashed together. The impact sent sparks flying through the empty tomb, sizzling out in the damp earth, leaving only the flashing light of their struggle to illuminate the damp air. The geist struck, fell back, struck again, each attack a sweep of talons that appeared out of its shadowed body and then disappeared just as quickly. Each time Gwen turned to face the demon, its form melted into the surrounding shadows, only to reappear somewhere else in the damp confines of the tomb. Every time she blocked its attack, a small fragment of her divine light dissipated. Suddenly, the assault ended, leaving a musty silence.
"You will not escape, demon,"
Gwen panted. She turned slowly in the center of the room, gathering her strength and her courage.
"I won't let you."
"Let me."
The geist's voice slithered in from the shadows.
"As if you have the strength to oppose the god of death."
"Sacombra held you, a mortal man, and without ancient rites."
Gwen drew herself up. The mantle of the autumn god glistened around her shoulders, shining brighter, filling the tomb with light. The dark geist crouched in the corner.
"If that fool can contain you, surely the huntress of Adair, holding the power of the god of autumn, can do no less."
"I was invited by the Grey Priest, not compelled. And when he was used up, I discarded him,"
the geist replied.
"For all your piety, you are no shaman. The autumn god is not yours to command, any more than the ocean bows to the will of the ship, or the storm to the fluttering leaf."
"Test my strength, and you will see your error, demon!"
Gwen shouted, her voice echoing off the walls. She reached out to the autumn god, drawing light into a bright spear of power that materialized in her hands. Something stirred beneath her soul, beyond the ken of her mind. She pushed it back and howled her fury.
"I will bind you or destroy you or both!"
"She flinches from your touch, child,"
the geist said. The pool of shadows that formed its body spread thin, leaking out into the cracked walls of the tomb.
"Your tame god will burn her leash and taste the blood of her master."
"Do not think to flee,"
Gwen shouted. She whirled around, trying to keep her attention in every corner of the damp room, burning still brighter to illuminate the lurking darkness.
Do not make me hunt you.
I have never been prey,
the Geist whispered. A column of barbed shadow launched out from the darkness, crashing into Gwen's bright shield. She resisted for a moment. Then the Geist's oil-black body lapped around her defenses, cutting deep. With a sudden impact, the demon threw her through the crumbling shell of the hill, punching her body through stone and sod until she flew free of the tomb. Gwen rolled as limp as a rag through the rough grass of the hallow, coming to rest among the poisoned flowers where Frère Lucas had nearly died. She lay there, the autumn god swirling around her. The spirit that was pinned to her soul thrashed like a fish on the line. The death god blossomed from the hill, rising into the sky on shadow-torn wings. It swept down the hill to where Gwen lay, settling on the edge of the clearing and grinning with its legion of teeth.
It will not need you much longer,
the Geist murmured, cocking its head curiously.
Your precious god will discard you, as I discarded that fool Sacumbra. Give in to it. Surrender. Why would you hold a god you don't understand?
Not understanding is part of it, Gwen muttered. I have Elsa to thank for that.
She struggled to her feet. The bright red petals of the poisoned flowers burst at her touch. The autumn god fought to get free. She could feel it pulling at her deepest flesh, at the tattered shards of her soul. Nevertheless, Gwen faced off against the swirling darkness at the edge of the field, wondering if it had been a mistake bringing death to this place. Maybe it would be her last mistake.
Poor, foolish child,
the Geist hissed. It grew over the clearing, its thin limbs weaving together into a canopy of night.
You were not this god's chosen avatar. It must have been an act of true desperation for the witches to sacrifice one so dreadfully unprepared. Have they fallen so far?
You talk too much, Gwen snapped.
I've been caged far too long, and that priest had nothing interesting to say. All damnation and vengeance and war.
The Geist continued to uncoil, reaching dark arms around the clearing, occulting the forest, and cutting Gwen off from the rest of the hallow.
There is plenty to enjoy, certainly, but butchery is bland, tasteless.
It crept closer, black tendrils drifting into the clearing like drops of ink in water.
Nothing as exquisite as the cultivated murder.
It's clear why you and Sacumbra got along so well, she responded. And surprising that you left him behind.
Death is not meant to be leashed, child,
the Geist answered.
Sacumbra should have known that. But you mortals, always dancing away from the darkness, thinking you can cheat the final tally. Summer always becomes winter. Birth is only the first step toward death.
As winter becomes spring, Gwen hissed. You seem to forget that, demon.
Demon? You should name me God, not demon.
The Geist swelled to its full height, glaring down at Gwen.
Have you abandoned the faith of your house so quickly? Has the death of your family shaken your beliefs?
The death of my...
Gwen shrank away.
What are you talking about?
Oh, yes. Yes, of course. You suspected, didn't you? But that is different from knowing. Here,
the Geist whispered, withdrawing a little, drawing a spindly arm back as though pulling aside a curtain. The air split, and shadows filled the sky.
I brought them with me, so that you might say goodbye.
A door opened in the shadows, and through it walked Gwen's father. He was fractured, like a statue, roughly hacked apart and then haphazardly rebuilt. Colm Adair's face was bloodless, the wounds that crossed his body puckered and raw, the skin peeling back like a toothless smile. When he saw his daughter, Colm tried to speak, but no words left his mouth. Only a painful, grating sound.
What have you done to him?
Gwen demanded. Something began to break inside of her, a pain as real and cold as a knife wound. She took a step forward.
What have you done to my father?
What have I done?
The Geist echoed.
Nothing. This is Sakumbra's work. And yours as well.
It waved another sinuous arm, and two more figures appeared in the shadows.
Your mother and brother fared no better, I am afraid, though their deaths were quicker. Lady Elspeth barely had time to scream, I think.
Elspeth and Grieg looked much as they had the last time Gwen had seen them, except for scarves of crimson blood that spilled from their throats and onto their breasts, the wounds in their necks still weeping. Young Grieg looked startled, but there was only fear in Elspeth's eyes.
The silence is the worst part,
the Geist said, motioning to Elspeth's flopping lips, the only sound a wet gurgle that bubbled from her severed throat.
Hardly fair, but I can remedy that and give them voice. Here.
The Geist floated behind them, the inky tendrils of its body caressing Lady Elspeth's pale corpse. A shadow passed through her skin and stitched shut the wound in her neck. Gwen's mother twisted around and took a startled breath, blood dribbling from her lips. Then she turned to Gwen and raised her hands.
I could do nothing,
she said.
Nothing. Sakumbra stepped from the shadows and snatched my son up like, as if to hug him. He turned my boy toward me and ran a blade across his throat.
Elspeth's eyes turned wet, tears spilling down her cheeks. She bent to Grieg, who stood swaying in the field, staring up at Gwen. Elspeth ran lily-white fingers over the sticky wound in her son's throat, as though she could close it with her touch. Her fingers trembled.
He killed my boy. He killed my son.
Stop it!
Gwen hissed. Her voice failed her, and she realized tears were streaming down her face. She backed away from the phantoms of her dead family.
Stop doing this! You're mocking them! You're mocking me!
I am showing you what you face,
the Geist answered. It rose up, sliding to the side of the three dead bodies. The wound in Elspeth's neck reopened, and her breath disappeared in a bubbling torrent of sobs.
They are mine now. Their bodies, their lives, Every memory you have of them, every happy moment you spent in their company, every hope you had for their future. Mine. Dead. Buried. In the grave. Mine is a blade that will never stop cutting, and from which no one can escape. Not even you.
You're a terrible god, Gwen muttered through her tears. A god of misery. I will never serve you.
No, but you will bow to me.
The geist drifted closer, its slate eyes narrowed, the wicked whisper of its claws dragging through the grass.
Everyone does. I am nothing like that tame bitch you're riding.
Something stirred in Gwen's bones, a torch of rage that whispered up from her soul. The autumn geist moved around her shoulders, quiet and angry. Gwen struggled for a breath, but then the god that was stitched to her bones broke through her skin, seizing control and speaking through her, its anger humming through her bones.
You have had your fun, Eldoriath,
a voice said, ringing with golden bells and fury.
The mortal child is broken, and my season is passing. But before I go, I will show you tame.
The words were not Gwen's, their meaning risen from a soul that had never known flesh.
The conclave was right to bury your madness. Now I must finish their job.
Which of us is truly risen, child?
The Deathgeist asked.
And which of us slept her way through the wars?
My dogs don't rise. They merely slip the leash for a while. Now put away your toys and face the rage of an endless god.
Like puppets whose strings had been cut, the dead of House Adair fell to the ground. Colm Adair came apart like a puzzle that had been dropped. Grieg and Elspeth fell together, their arms folding over each other in a final embrace, mother comforting son, son seeking the sanctuary of his mother's love. It broke Gwen to watch, but she could do nothing. The autumn geist filled the clearing with sunset light. The poison flowers wilted, their petals breaking into new growths that squirmed between the grasses like snakes. Eldoriath burst forth, squeezing the clearing with the domed darkness of its limbs, trying to crush Gwen and Foamhara in a web of night. Like a coal smothered in ashes, Gwen burned hotter and hotter, brighter and brighter, until the flames of the autumn geist slowly started breaking through the death god's trap. The tangled web of its attack started to give. One night-dark strand snapped, and then a second. And then Gwen rose, and the god threw her. She rose into the sky on a spear of light, a pillar of golden leaves that shuffled over her flesh like velvet. At the base, the Deathgeist lay in a heap, like a rubble of broken trees. Slowly, it patched itself together, gathering the shattered bits of its body together. Foamhara laughed, and the sound shook the forest.
Nothing clever left to say. No more promises of death or exquisite murder.
Gwen looked down at the death god and laughed again.
Well, I'm glad to have shut you up once and for...
Gwen started to fall. Chapter 2 The dim light of dozens of campfires stretched to the horizon, their flames flickering beneath the banners of the south. Tents creaked in the stiff autumn wind, and laughter drifted up from the Sudren camp. Above them, the sky was crowned in glittering stars, and Cinder's pale face hung like a coin in the sky. A second camp clustered inside of the Fengate's ruined walls. The Tenarans were a somber lot, staying close to the castle walls and talking quietly among themselves. The guards that roamed the perimeter were deadly serious, as scared of the Sudren army as they were of the coiled shadows of the forest. The season of mad gods was at hand, and only a fool would walk the night alone, especially in a castle as haunted as the Fengate was purported to be. The center of the castle was mostly ruin. The famous towers of Adair's keep lay in shambles, the shattered doma and attendant halls haphazardly repaired. The only buildings that were untouched by the Fengod's assault were the stables, the kennel, and the lonely splinter of the Huntress's tower.
"Will they ever go home?"
Malcolm muttered. He stood on what remained of the Fengate's battlement, cloak clutched tightly to his chin, the chill of the coming winter sharp in his bones. Castian Jardin stood beside him, along with a handful of guards. Jardin stomped his feet against the wall, trying to hammer some warmth into his toes. The Duke of Redgarden sighed.
"They have no taste for winter. A good frost will drive them back to the burning coast," Jardin said. "Somehow I think their spirit will not be so easily broken,"
Malcolm answered.
"Half their number has already retreated to Sudra. The rest will follow, in time. And God's bless it soon, so that I may join them and leave this miserable land,"
Jardin said unhappily. Malcolm chuckled. His friend was bound temple to toe in fur and misery.
"You are welcome to return home, Redgarden,"
Malcolm said.
"Roard has joined his banner to our cause, and Sacumbra's heresy has taken the fire from the Sudren host. This war is all but over."
Jardin grunted. He nodded toward the two opposing camps and the slow orbit of guards.
"This does not look like a field of peace,"
he said.
"No,"
Malcolm said.
"It does not. We must be careful, Malcolm. This was a short fight, a short season of war. These armies are merely what Halvert was able to draw to his cause in a few months, bolstered by Sacumbra's support."
Jardin paused for a moment, weighing his words.
"There are many spears in the south, many that have not yet stirred. We must play our cards carefully to keep them there. It is good that Roard stands with us, but not enough."
"You worry about Sudra,"
Malcolm said.
"I get messages from the north every day, promising support should Halvert's host push further in their direction, promising spears and horses and the full fury of Tene. We were lucky to keep them out of the fight so far. If Sudra escalates, we will not be so fortunate."
He gestured down to the camps clustered below.
"The smart ones have gone home. Only the stubborn remain." "The stubborn and the zealous,"
Castian answered.
"Those who travel south carry stories of Adair's heresy, along with the bodies of their dead. Their families will mourn. And then, perhaps, they will march to avenge those deaths.
May I? May nay?
Malcolm said.
Gods will know soon enough.
Jardin didn't answer. He just stood there, beating his feet against the stone and muttering. A messenger picked his way up the tumbling stairs to approach the two dukes. One of the guards intercepted the man, checking his identity and searching for weapons among the bundled bulk of his cloak and armor. Castian and Malcolm watched.
This weather really is foul,
Castian muttered.
I don't know how you stand it.
There is a reason we invented whiskey, Red Garden. It keeps winter at bay.
Last time I was at the Doma, the Frere sang the autumn bell,
Castian answered.
We are barely out of summer, Hound Hallow.
Winter has come early,
Malcolm agreed with a nod.
And sharp.
My scouts say that a dozen leagues to our south the weather breaks. Gentle autumn still reigns in most of Tenumbra, Malcolm. It's only our little ruin that suffers,
Castian said, hopping lightly from foot to foot.
If there was any doubt, this place was cursed before.
Enough of that talk,
Malcolm said sharply.
My men already jump at every shadow and mouse. No need for them to hear their lords discussing curses.
He raised his voice to the guards.
Let the man through, Ein. If he has a hidden blade under all those layers, it will take the better part of the night for him to draw it.
The guard grudgingly obeyed, but kept a close eye on the messenger. Malcolm saw why the man mistrusted the newcomer. He was dressed in the black and gold of the church.
News from Hartsbridge?
Malcolm asked.
Aye, my lord, the man said. His Holiness, Gaston Le Brieux, Celestriarch of Cinder and Strife, sends his greetings and deepest thanks for your role in uncovering the heresy of the High Inquisitor.
And the heresy of dear Colmadair, I imagine,
Malcolm muttered.
Gods know what they'll make of that in Hartsbridge.
Such matters will be left in the Inquisitor's hands, I am sure,
the messenger said with a bow.
Inquisitor?
Malcolm asked.
Listen, the Celestriarch may be a little behind in the proceedings, but Frere Lucas left us some weeks ago. There's no other representative of the Inquisition at the Fen Gate.
Precisely, the man said, which is why a new Inquisitor will be here shortly. I left his company a day ago to give you fair warning that his chambers might be prepared.
A day ago?
Malcolm asked.
Yes, the messenger answered. He should be here
in the morning,
Jardin finished.
Well,
Malcolm said stiffly. He turned to Castian and nodded his farewell.
I have preparations to make, I suppose.
Ein, see that this man is given something to eat and a blanket to sleep on.
My lord,
the guard said.
Where will we put them?
Castian asked.
It's not like the keep's fit for habitation. It wouldn't do to have the roof fall on their heads while they pray. Gods know what the church would make of that.
No, and I'm not sure I want to put him in Gwendolyn's tower,
Malcolm answered.
Not until we know the depth and craft of her heresy. It could be dangerous.
Dangerous?
Castian said.
I sleep in the Huntress's tower, Malcolm.
And you're a braver man for it,
Malcolm answered with a smile.
But no, we can't have them in the keep nor in the tower, and there's no more room in the courtyard, even if the Frere was willing to take a tent. I must think of something.
Perhaps the Sudrans could serve host to the Inquisitor,
the messenger said sharply. If you can't find a bed worthy of the Celestriarch's chosen envoy.
The Inquisitor did not come all this way to sleep outside the walls,
Castian said.
Last I checked, the Sudran host was out there, and we are in here.
And they haven't the numbers to shift us,
Malcolm said.
That much we've proven.
Not yet, the messenger said. Malcolm and Castian grew still, staring at the man. They haven't the numbers to shift you, yet. He glanced up from his stiff bow to crack a smile. How many would it take, do you think?
What have you seen?
Castian snapped.
You traveled here from Hartsbridge. What did you pass along the way?
Again, I will leave that for the Inquisitor. He turned to the guard. There was talk of a bed. It has been a long day. Malcolm kept his eyes on the messenger. After a moment, he nodded stiffly to the guard, watching as the man was led away. When they were alone on the parapet, he turned to Castian.
What was that about?
He asked.
A threat? A warning?
Castian ventured.
Perhaps the Inquisition will stir up trouble as they come north. I would not put it past them. They won't want the Circle of Lords to focus on Sacombra, not for too long. Better that the Dukes worry about the threat of Tenere.
The threat of Tenere,
Malcolm said.
The threat of the pagan knight.
Whether real or not,
Castian agreed.
Best we find the Inquisitor a comfortable bed.
I'd hope to have the Doma repaired before anyone from Hartsbridge arrived,
Malcolm said with a sigh.
I wanted them to find us faithful, singing the evensong, observing the rites.
They know of your faith, Malcolm,
Castian said.
Do they? Perhaps.
Malcolm stirred himself and started toward the stairs.
I'll leave you to this miserable view, Red Garden. If there is a Sudrin army marching north, I must speak with my fellow lords before news of it reaches the camps. Good night, Houndhallow,
Castian said, turning back to stare uncomfortably over the vista.
And Godspeed.
Malcolm hurried down the stairs, nearly tripping on the broken stones of the stairwell. Morning didn't give him much time, and there was much to do. Grant Mayheron was waiting at the base of the wall. The big man was dressed for battle, his axe cradled loosely in his arms like a child. The heir of the Fell Tower, still presumptive until his father's death could be confirmed, was never far from his axe. The edge shone as bright as silver in the torchlight. Malcolm nodded.
We have guests coming, Fell Tower.
Sir Mayheron, if you please,
the man rumbled.
My father may live.
You must accept his passing, Grant,
Malcolm said quietly. He had known the boy since his birth. Grant Mayheron was a few years older than his own son, and had always kept himself apart from the rest of the children of the Teneran court, but it was hard to think of him as the Duke of the Fell Tower.
You must accept your father's death and his title. Your men need you. We all need you.
He may live,
Grant repeated stubbornly, hugging the weapon closer. Malcolm sighed, but shook his head.
We will discuss this another day. For now, there is news from the south, and preparations to be made.
I saw the church's messenger when he arrived,
Grant said.
His horse was near dead. The Inquisition is coming.
They'll be here in the morning,
Malcolm said.
But that is not our greatest worry. Are the other lords awake?
Roward and his whelp watch the gate. Dougal and Thane take some rest. Jardin was with you. I don't know where the others are.
Gather them. The Tenerans only. Leave Roward at his watch,
Malcolm said.
What of Redain's host? Who commands the men of the Drowned Hall?
His master of guard, a man named Franklin Gast. Word has been sent to ascertain the will of Redain's heir,
Grant said.
They may leave us.
Go wake them, and bring them to what remains of the Doma. We have much to discuss.
Are we finally breaching the subject of surrender?
Grant asked.
Wait for the Doma,
Malcolm said.
We will have a fray, bless the meeting, and then we will see what is necessary.
Grant Mayheron nodded gruffly, then left, still clutching his axe. That man would not surrender easily, Malcolm knew, either his hope or this castle. He turned and slipped into the shadows of the ruined keep. Hurrying through the corridors, he nodded imperceptibly to each of the dozen hidden guards who protected this part of the castle from curious eyes. They were dressed as stablers, cooks, pages shirking their duties in the abandoned halls of the castle. But each wore chain under their disguise and kept sword and spear near to hand. They let Malcolm pass without comment. He came to a door and knocked. There were muffled voices inside.
Who goes?
Her husband,
Malcolm answered, careful to not use his name or station. Anyone trying to impersonate him would surely draw on the Duke's authority to bull his or her way inside.
Let me in, Dune.
He heard someone pull aside the cloth that was jammed beneath the door, a dim light filling the corridor as soon as it was clear. Locks were thrown. Ser Dune eased the door open, her eyes flicking past Malcolm to the corridor beyond. Once she was sure things were safe, she urged Malcolm inside and closed the door. The locks were in place before Malcolm's eyes had adjusted to the gloom. His wife provided the only light in the room. The witch's touch that had saved her life and cursed her flesh had changed Sorcha into a creature of strange light and stranger mien. She sat in a chair of fitted stone, its surface weeping with condensation. There were no windows in the narrow chamber, but Lady Blakeley still stared wistfully to the west, the direction her son had traveled weeks ago. Her veins glowed with murky light. Sorcha's blood was gone, transformed into clear, bright liquid that flickered with an inner light. When she glanced at Malcolm, her eyes were deep pools of shimmering water, and her hair shifted restlessly around her head like a crown of seaweed. Malcolm went to one knee beside her.
My love,
he whispered,
we must go.
Chapter 3. Gwen fell and didn't stop. Whatever strange link held her in the pillar of light was coming loose. Panic welling up, she could feel her soul snagging on some unseen line as she tumbled through the leaves, struck the ground with a thump, bounced, crashed down again. Her breath left her, and her skull rang like a bell. As she lay there, senseless for a moment, her vision swam with the forest and the sky and the towering body of the autumn geist. Gwen tried to stand, but the strength was gone from her limbs. She tried to cry out, but could only gape like a beached fish. Her breath began to come back to her when an unspeakable force grabbed her and dragged her along the forest floor. Gwen bounced from tree to mossy stone, digging a rut in the damp sod whenever she thumped back to earth. She lurched, jerking along for a dozen yards and then stopping. Pulled forward again, going through bracken bush and grassy field. Finally, between crashing jerks, she was able to reach her feet and look around. The autumn geist had been dragging her like a forgotten toy. A fragile net of amber light trailed from the god's body, tangling among Gwen's limbs, disappearing into her flesh and emerging again. Before she could say or do anything, the geist took another massive step, jerking her off her feet and crashing through the forest. Fomhara stopped again, and Gwen was able to quickly regain her feet.
"Wait!" she shouted. "Where are you going? Come back!"
"You do not hold me, child,"
the geist breathed, its voice humming through Gwen's skull.
"And my season is done."
"But I need... we must... the demon..."
"We must nothing,"
Fomhara said, then turned away and continued its journey. Gwen fell, tumbled, and was dragged through a field of raw stone before coming to rest on the pebbled beach of the river that bounded the hollow. From her knees, Gwen could see the bluffs beyond. She was about to cry out when the geist moved again. Gwen tumbled into the river. The cold took her breath and her sense. She fought against the current, but no matter which way she thrashed, she was dragged deeper under the surface. Her lungs burned, already empty from screaming and the constant thudding impacts of her journey. The strands of light that tied her to the towering geist pulled her forward. By the time she reached the far shore, Gwen was limp as a rag. River water poured clear and cold from her mouth as she was pulled up the beach. The sky and stones rolled over her. Her mind drifted. She would be shattered against the stone cliffs, or dragged into a lake, or left to freeze somewhere in the wilds of the fen. She was dead. She was ruined. Gwen tumbled against something stuck into the stones of the beach. It was warm to the touch, and when she folded over it, it cut her like a knife.
Like a sword.
Gwen opened her eyes. Sir Lefay's lost blade stuck like a mast from the ground. When the geist moved forward, the skeins of light that bound it to Gwen strained against the blade. She thought she might be cut in half, and blood poured dark and hot from her wounds, but she stayed put. She wrapped her hands around the hilt and pulled her belly away from the cutting edge. The geist tugged again. The lines pulled taut, humming with the strain. And then they snapped. As she collapsed to the beach, Gwen's blood mixed with water that was still streaming from her nostrils. She whimpered as the injuries crashed through her mind, lay there as the amber light of the autumn god dimmed on the horizon, and then was gone. Her hands had been cut deeply by the blade, and the wounds inflicted by the death geist festered with wicked shadows. The first footfall was nearly silent, the practiced stride of a woodland hunter, taught by the wolf and the whisper. A shadow lurked among the trees, bright eyes staring at the fallen huntress. It was joined by another shadow, and then a third, and then the forest was full of silent spears. Call stepped from among the trees, followed by a cadre of pagans with their cloaks and spears and crowns of willow. He walked to Gwen and knelt beside her broken body. He glanced at the sword, Gwen's blood leaking into the runes of strife, remnants of heat curling off the blade.
"It is the Untress,"
he said finally. He gathered her into his arms and stood. Her arms hung limp, trailing ribbons of blood.
"There is still time for a soul, if not a flesh. She has lost the god,"
one of his companions said sharply. It was a man tattooed with a mask of leaves.
"Fiona said she would fail us. What good is she to us now?"
"You have lost too much of yourself, Aiden. She is not a forest to be burned for our warmth."
Call stretched his cloak to cover Gwen's unconscious body, then nodded to his other companion. The young boy, little more than a child, stepped forward eagerly.
"Taven, stay here. They will come looking for her, or for what happened to her. Warn them that the god of death has slipped its chains, and that the autumn god is lost as well."
He started to turn away, paused, glared at the sword.
"And see that the Vow Knight gets her sword back, but be sure that she knows the cost of that blade and the weight of the death that goes with it."
"I will,"
Taven said seriously. Without another word, Call slipped among the trees. Within moments, the beach was empty of all but the young pagan and the blade and the sound of shadows in the forest. Chapter 4. Ian bent his head close to the charger's neck and spurred the beast on. The forest whipped past them, branches scoring bloody tracks across his cheeks. The only light was the dim image of Elsa LeFay's fleeing form, sunlight leaking from her armor, briefly illuminating the narrow path before surrendering to the shadows. The sound of his horse, the whistling passage of trees, the hammering of his heart, all filled Ian's head and drowned out any other thought but flight and fear. Behind them, a mad god followed. It brushed aside the trees as though they were bowling pins, roots popping out of the soil with dull, squelching sounds, trunks groaning as they fell. The earth shook. Ian spared a glance over his shoulder. The geist's back writhed with 1,000 barbed quills that rustled dryly as they slithered together. Its head was a thick lump, mouthless, bristling with smooth black eyes. The creature was falling back, however, until only the mosaic of its eyes was visible in the scant light that shone from Elsa's invocations. Ian smiled, turned back to the trail, and had to react quickly. Elsa was stopped, her mount pulled up and stomping sideways on the path. The Vow Knight was leaning over the saddle and looking down. Beyond her, there was nothing. Ian pulled hard on his reins. His horse complained, skidding on the damp ground as it dug iron-shod hooves into the earth. He came up just short of a ravine, its edges sharp with rocky debris. Water crashed far below.
This way,
Elsa said quickly. Then she set off along the ravine's lip. Both directions looked the same to Ian, a jagged cliff that stretched into the darkness. He briefly considered abandoning the Vow Knight, counting on her holy glow to draw the Geist, but he would be lost without her. And even if he survived this attack, Ian would be helpless against the next. So he pulled his horse in line and spurred forward, trying to keep up. He glanced back again to see if their pursuer would pick up their scent. The Geist skidded to a halt, large stones clattering over the edge of the ravine to drop loudly into the noisy river below. It looked around, its coat of barbed quills undulating silently, and saw them. It was terribly still for a heartbeat, watching them with its multitude of eyes. Then it followed, moving faster now that it was clear of the trees. Ian turned toward Elsa.
We should get back to the forest, he yelled.
Geists have boundaries, Elsa replied. Even ferals have rules.
You think we'll be safe across the river?
No idea, she said. But we weren't safe in the forest, and the horses can't keep this up much longer. We need to find a place to cross.
She was right. Ian's mount was quivering under his thighs. Between the constant riding and frequent pursuit, these horses didn't have much left in them. The last thing he wanted was to have to walk out of the fen. He had done it once, but that had been in the company of a witching wife and her shaman. There had been fewer Geists that time, too. Fewer by far. The barbed, bristling god came closer, and their mounts were slowing. Ian pulled up next to Elsa, the Vow Knight's mount trembling at the verge of collapse. Lefay's scarred cheeks were bright with embers. She was burning her blood to keep the horses going, but there was only so much Strife's magic could do. The pair exchanged a look. Elsa shook her head.
No further, she said.
Ian looked around. This far from the forest's edge, they were on a broad ledge of stone and moss. The horses stumbled to a halt, and Elsa slid from her saddle. She started adjusting her armor, cutting the buckles on several heavier pieces and throwing them away to clatter on the rocks.
So here then, Ian said. Keep going,
Elsa said. Her voice was ragged.
I can hold it for a while.
No, Ian answered. He slid to the ground, twisted, and cracked his back, staring down the ravine at the rapidly closing Geist.
Even if my horse could go another step. No. This is my death as much as it is yours. Have a little faith,
Elsa said smartly.
I may yet live. I'm wearing armor, at least.
Ah, but I'm faster on my feet.
Just fast enough to die fancy,
she said, holding her sword at arm's length, frowning at the blade. It was plain and gray, without the blood-rot runes of the Winter Vow. Elsa had lost her sword at the Witch's Hallow when Gwen's magical presence had swept her miles away in the blink of an eye. This blade came from the Fengate's armory.
If only I had my true sword.
Always making excuses, Ian said. You don't see me complaining.
No one expects much of the half-heretic son of Hound Hallow, she replied. Once I'm gone, this forest will swallow you whole. You're fucked, Blakeley.
And then the Geist was on them. It leapt into the air, its broad limbs going wide, claws extended, the barbed cloak of its back bristling against the night. It grew larger and larger as it jumped, its eyes twinkling brightly, and then its chest split. An ebon slash ran from throat to groin, widening as it fell toward them, until pure darkness filled the sky. The creature's form dissolved into the air. Its quills flaked away, becoming motes of sharp light that fluttered down like snowflakes. Its eyes scattered and became stars, twisting into unfamiliar constellations in a moonless sky. Its body dissipated into inky smoke that curled between the trees. Talons clattered to the ground. The river was gone. The horses were gone. They were somewhere else.
"So,"
Elsa said, still in guard position. Her sword leaked molten light, the metal of the blade popping as it fried in Elsa's hands. "We seem to have found a new and interesting way to die," Ian said. He slid his blade from its scabbard. "Though I don't remember dying. Is this the quiet?"
"I'm not the sort of priest who could tell you," Elsa said. "Though I think not."
The ground around them turned into soft loam, sprouting with tufts of pale grass that bore a disturbing resemblance to the creature's quills. The forest was there, but at a distance, and a thick fog swirled around them, as black as night.
"Your light is dimming," Ian said.
"I'm tired."
"No, I mean..." He stepped closer. "It's as though the air is eating it."
Elsa looked down. The cloak of sunlight that wafted off of her armor was evaporating, like cobwebs touched to flame. She grunted.
"This is more than darkness," she said. "I can see the stars just fine."
"Yes, though they are no less disturbing," Ian said.
While they watched, the constellations disappeared in an undulating wave to shine brighter as they reappeared.
"I've heard tell of geists like this," Elsa said. "They are a place rather than a deity. A realm."
"So it ate us?"
"Absorbed, more like," Elsa said, creeping carefully forward. "But not the horses. Lucky horses. May I, may nay."
Elsa clenched her shoulders, straining against the darkness. Her sun-touched aura flared briefly and then flickered out. The Vow Knight staggered, and Ian reached for her. She shrugged his hand away. After a few heartbeats of silence, she shook her head, her voice rough.
"We will not be burning our way out of this."
"Is that always your first instinct, Sir Lefay?" Ian asked gently.
"First and last and always," she answered. "Come. There must be a way forward."
Despite the darkness, they could see where they walked, though the view bore no distinguishing landmarks. There was the distant forest, which never seemed to get closer, the barbed grass that clattered peacefully in the slight breeze, and the sky of unfamiliar stars that occasionally blinked in horizon-spanning waves. They walked aimlessly.
"There is something among the trees," Ian whispered.
"Yes,"
Elsa answered. He could just barely see it out of the corner of his eye, a cloak flickering between branches, eyes the color of distant stars. A pack of predators, perhaps wolves, followed the apparition, stepping lightly through the forest like a fog.
"The god, do you think?"
"Or his demons. You're the one steeped in pagan lore, young Hound Hallow. What is this place?
Ian kept looking around, stepping carefully among the tufts of grass, straining his ears for any hint of the river they had left behind. The trees were filled with strange sounds, like dry bones rubbing together, and the rattle of insect song. "This is the night," he said finally.
"That is close enough."
A voice came from in front of them, sounding like velvet carefully cut by the sharpest shears, as quiet and soft as a sigh. Abruptly, they were at the tree line. Part of the darkness solidified, and a hunched figure stepped out. His face was smooth and dark, and his hair was pale. It was difficult to focus on his features. Ian's gaze kept sliding away from the man's glittering eyes, though his mouth hung in Ian's vision like an afterimage, teeth and lips set in a grimace, the corners cracked and wet.
"Why are you crossing through my realm?"
"Crossing through?" Elsa asked. "You brought us here. We'd be happy to leave."
"That cannot be."
The man twitched, his head shifting like a king settling his crown. A palsied hand appeared from behind the figure to briefly touch his heart.
"All come to me. All are gathered to this realm. I have never sought another to bring them in. You must be mistaken."
"And yet, here we are," Ian said.
"Indeed,"
the man said, bowing slightly at the waist.
"And so I ask, what has brought you and the others to my realm?"
"The others?" Ian asked. He looked around, saw nothing but the stars and the forest and the darkness. "What others?"
"Men of steel and ink. There is a familiar taste to them, but I am a stranger to their arts. They have forsaken me."
The man looked Ian over, lingering on his face, as though trying to recall him from some memory.
"There is something of me in your heart, however. Who are you?"
"Ian Blakeley of Hound Hollow," Ian replied. "I am..."
"The hound hunts through my forests during the day, but cowers at his master's fire when I come to him."
The man looked from Ian to Elsa, smiling as though he had made a joke.
"My realm is for wolves, Ian of Hounds. Best you get going before they find you."
"This is worthless," Elsa spat.
She strode forward, her gait stiff, blade swept back and ready at her thigh. The loamy ground swelled beneath her feet, wrinkling into ridges that absorbed her steps. She stumbled on, but with each step her feet sunk deeper and deeper into the ground, until thick moss was churning around her waist. She shouted in frustration, and a wave of flickering light washed over the ground. The grasses crisped and turned to ash. The ground shrank away from her.
"That was hardly proper,"
the strange man said. He was no longer close to them, his still form standing off to one side, fingertips lightly brushing the cracked flesh of his lips.
"I know your kind, summer child. You have your own realm. Leave me to mine."
"Then return me, or I'll cut my way through,"
Hardly proper,
the man repeated. Then he began to fade into the trees.
Wait!
Ian shouted. He ran forward, and the world seemed to tilt, causing him to drop his sword. It disappeared in the darkness. He found himself running uphill, though the ground remained steady. Ian pressed on.
You can't leave us here!
The man looked startled at his approach and shrank back. Ian reached the trees and used them to pull himself forward. The world tipped again, and he was suddenly hopping from trunk to trunk like the rungs of a giant's ladder. He glanced behind, and Elsa's light shone dimly in the fog. From this distance, it looked as though she were trapped in a cage of branches, her blade flashing back and forth. Ian struggled on. His hand came down on something cold. Instantly, a wetness spread down his arm to drip from his elbow. His hand was wrapped around the blade of a sword, its tip buried in the trunk of a tree. He jerked back, blood trailing from his split palm, pain reaching his senses. Shaking his fingers, he examined the wound, a narrow cut, not deep enough to reach muscle, but bleeding like a split wineskin. He looked up at the tree and saw that it was a collection of arms and armor. Spears rattled against branches, broken helms hung like rusty fruit, and bodies. A half dozen bodies dangled, their faces cloaked in mist, their limbs twisted as if in some final spasm of horror.
The others, Ian whispered to himself.
He crept closer, careful where he placed his hands and feet, until he was alongside one of the bodies. It turned slowly on a length of chain, its limbs wasted and thin. The corpse wore the black tabard of House Tiber, the sigil of the Earl of Cindermouth, the pale hand seared with a crescent moon on the palm, hung in tatters from the dead man's chest. Again, the forest changed. It became vertical, the ground a sheer cliff from which the trees emerged like arrow shafts. They shifted and formed a thick web of stone-hard wood, their canopies lost in swirling fog, their roots pulling free of the earth until there was no ground, only the directionless maze of branches and trunks, wiry limbs that snarled together. And still, Ian climbed. There was a light ahead. It was Elsa. She hung in the middle of a tangled ball of wicker, limbs bound and skin scratched raw. A steady flame flickered from the blade of her sword, and the branches around it were charred black. Then the steel, untempered in the holy forge of the light fort, began to fail. On seeing Ian, she struggled to turn toward him. The trees resisted, groaning as she twisted in their grasp. Her face was clutched by whip-thin branches that burrowed into her flesh. The blood that leaked from those wounds was stained with ash.
I have no power here,
she whispered.
I burn, and the tree falls away, but eventually it returns, and this blade will not last much longer. Where have you been?
Climbing, Ian said. I just left your side.
Hours ago,
she said.
Where is our friend?
Ian looked up into the maze of tree, and then down. Fog swirled all around.
I don't know, he admitted, but I think I found the others he was talking about.
Men of Tiber, long dead. I wonder what they were doing in the fen.
An interesting question, for a later time,
Elsa said. Ian raised his brows. Do you want me to cut you free? He asked.
No, Ian. I want you to leave me to die,
she said tightly.
You idiot.
Ian reached for his sword, then remembered. There was a knife in his boot, though, so he drew that and started working on the tangle of branches that held Sir Lefay in place. The wood was tough, the bark cutting his knuckles as he sawed through it, and the flesh beneath was dense and fibrous. Still, he cut and cut, his own blood running down his fingers until the handle of the knife was red and slick. The first branch snapped, and then another. He burrowed deeper into the tangle of wood, grabbing handfuls of branches and putting them to the knife. The tree creaked around him.
Careful,
Elsa hissed. Ian glanced up with a smile.
Don't worry. It's not like you're going to fall or anything.
No, you idiot! The tree! Ian looked back down at his hands. Thin branches were cradling his wrists, and as he jerked his arms back, they looped as tight as a snare, trapping him. He yelped and started cutting at his restraints, but other branches coiled closer, hooking into his elbows, twining between his fingers, drinking the blood of his wounds. He dropped the knife and watched as the tree pulled it away, wrapping it in wicker until it disappeared. Ian fell backward, winning free of the trap, but barely catching himself before he fell. Elsa watched with a frown as he scrambled to find his footing.
My hero,
she muttered. That didn't go as planned.
No, she said. And here I thought your goal was to be caught here with me, that we might spend eternity in this nightmare.
She closed her eyes and leaned back, sighing mightily.
The horses had the right of it.
I'll find the Geist, Ian insisted. I'll get him to let us go.
Without so much as a knife? Perhaps you can trick him with your clever wordplay.
I'll think of something.
Yes, Elsa said. I'm sure you will.
He grimaced and started climbing again. Quickly, the fog hid Elsa from his sight. He climbed for what felt like an eternity, and then he climbed some more. Elsa's tangled cage came into view again. He looked around, and there, just to one side, was the tree of dead Tanarans, looking more wasted than before. He was going in circles, and time was moving in ways that made no sense. Ian settled against the nearest trunk and closed his eyes. He wondered why he wasn't tired, or if maybe he was so tired that he couldn't tell the difference. He stared at the swirling fog where the tree's canopy should be, and then he realized that his eyes were closed, but he could still see. He opened his eyes. Nothing changed. Night, he whispered to himself. Night and the land of dreams. And so the logic of dreams. Ian shimmied along the trunk toward where the canopy should be, getting closer and closer to the fog. The tree branched, the limbs getting thinner and thinner until they creaked under Ian's weight. A crown of dry leaves shook free, spinning down into the distance. He reached the tip of the tree. There was nothing beyond it but fog. So, he jumped. Chapter 5. The stones were stained with the blood of the choir. Rough rows of barrels and broken wood served as pews, while the altar had mostly survived the attack of the feral god. There was still much work to be done. The shell of the doma was shattered, patched with canvas and clapboard, the air still raw with the stink of massacre. Most of the repairs had been done by volunteers, faithful soldiers and stewards who wanted to return the sanctuary to a place of worship. Malcolm had served more than one shift among the rubble, dressed in simple linens, lending a hand where he was able. The room was silent when he entered, though not empty. Duke Lorien Roard sat next to the altar, sleep still heavy on his face, wrapped in a cloak of black leather that was apparently insufficient against the cold. Castian Jardin, still dressed in his furs and misery, stood at his side. The Sudrans were separated from the rest of the Lords of Tenumbra. Grant Mayheron, along with Uwen Thane and Manson Dougal, lingered among the ruined pews. Those three were the last Tenaran lords who had sworn to the Fengate's defense. Another man stood nearby, his back to the wall, dressed in simple mail and resting his hands on the hilt of his battered sword. When Malcolm came in, this man started and nearly drew his blade. Malcolm gave him a nod.
"You must be Sagast, Rudain's man," Malcolm said.
The knight grunted and offered a hand for Malcolm to shake.
"It is good of you to offer your leadership at this time. It is more than your lord could have asked."
"He can't ask me anything from the grave,"
Gast said.
"And it matters little enough. I was brought up to lead men in battle, and this is close enough to battle to not make a difference."
"Is there any word from the Drowned Hall? Rudain's heir must have heard of his fate by now,"
Malcolm asked.
"I sent a rider with his helm and my sympathies."
"Aye, and we thank you for that. Lady Mariah wasn't happy to be left behind. She may command us back, or she may join us here, or neither, or both."
Gast shrugged mightily. He had scars all along the back of his neck, and more on his scalp and hands. His hair, gray-black and bristly, was patchy around the white skin of old wounds. Malcolm thought that they must be of an age, he and this grizzled knight. He couldn't help but wonder if he looked as roughly handled. When he took Gast's hand and shook it, there was great strength there. Turning toward the rest of the gathering, Malcolm walked to the center of the room. They watched him nervously. Other than the handful of torches that flickered throughout the chamber, there was no heat among the stones, and little light.
"So, you have us here, torn from our beds and our duties,"
Lorien Roard said. The Duke of Stormwatch looked miserable, and he made no effort to keep it from his voice.
"To what purpose, Houndhallow?"
"I have a guess,"
Castian muttered,
"though I doubt it will bring us any joy."
"Yes,"
Malcolm acknowledged.
"We've had a messenger. Duke Jardin was with me when I received him. Hartsbridge has sent us an inquisitor. He will be here in the morning."
"Couldn't be soon enough, as far as I'm concerned,"
Mayheron said.
"It will take more than our narrow faith to cleanse Adair's curse from these stones."
"Do we trust the Inquisition to do that?"
Manson Dougal asked.
It was Sicombra who brought a god of death to our walls and stirred Sudra to war under false pretenses.
Hardly false,
Maharan said, giving his fellow Tanaran a sidelong look.
There can be no doubt as to Colmadair's heresy.
Nor Sicombra's, Roard answered, though I don't imagine those wash each other out.
If we're not going to trust the Inquisition, then who can we place our faith in?
Maharan snapped. His land sat in the shadow of Cinderfell, the shrine of Lord Cinder and heart of the Inquisition in the north, so his reaction could be anticipated. But it made Malcolm uncomfortable, especially considering the troubles to come.
Sicombra will face his crimes as Colmadair never will.
Because he's dead,
Malcolm said.
Listen, there is fault to be found on both sides of this fight. I will welcome the Inquisitor when he arrives, and keep an eye on him as he works. A little more discretion on Lord Alvert's part might have prevented this entire war.
As a little more discretion on your part might have unearthed Adair's heresy before now. That it took a heretic to reveal a heretic does not speak well of the North,
Roard said from his place by the altar. The rest of the room bristled, even Castian Jardin. He placed a hand on Roard's shoulder.
Let's not be casting judgment around like seeds to be sown, Stormwatch, Jardin whispered. We are here as allies, after all.
Let's not forget that this man marched north at Halvert's side in the first place,
Dougal said sharply.
I'm not sure why he's included in this council.
He's here because when our other defenses had fallen, he and his son held the gate against the Sudran charge. Without him, most of our host would be dead,
Malcolm said,
including my son.
Where is your son, Hound Hallow?
Dougal asked.
I haven't seen him since the battle. Has he returned to your castle to prepare your defenses, should we fail here?
He travels with the Vow Knight, Sir Elsa Le Fay, seeking Gwendolyn Adair,
Malcolm answered.
Against my urging, of course.
And your wife?
She is still recovering from her wounds,
Malcolm answered smoothly, shooting Maharan a glance.
I hope to return her to Oundalo before winter.
Hopefully the Inquisitor will be able to help with that,
Dougal said.
Though healing is more Strife's domain.
Hopefully,
Malcolm said.
But that is not why I called you together. The Church's messenger also brought word from the south.
From Hartsbridge? Roard asked. A declaration of the Church, or from the Circle of Lords?
No declaration of the Sudran Circle will hold weight in these walls,
Uwen Thane muttered.
Not while there's Tanaran blood in my veins.
The Circle of Lords is our greatest hope, Roard snapped. There is an army outside these walls that is overburdened with grudges. Marchand will stand by Halvert's quest, especially now that his accusations against Adair have proven true. And with Emile Fabron dead by your hand, Blakeley, his men aren't going to skulk back to the Black Mountain, not without a taste of vengeance.
Laguerre returned south, but probably to raise more banners and stir the hearts of Sudra,
Jardin interrupted.
He left most of his men behind, with orders to keep us bottled up until he returned.
Exactly. And it's not like any of you are going to surrender the Fengate without a fight,
Roard continued.
These are Tanaran stones, and this is Tanaran soil,
Thane said simply.
Tanaran lives will defend it.
Tainted with Tanaran heresy,
Jardin muttered, but Roard ignored him.
Which is why we must put our hope in the Circle of Lords, Roard said. If cooler heads prevail in Sudra, they can convince those who remain here to come home.
For now, at least, it would be a false hope, Malcolm said. The messenger spoke very loosely, but it seems as if the hosts of Sudra are marching north.
We've faced many of their number already,
Mayheron said.
How many could remain?
Many of them scattered when the... Roard paused, looking uncomfortably around the ruined doma.
When Lady Gwyn appeared. Those banners would need to be gathered again, and if the Circle has committed to deciding this matter by force, they could call many more swords from their vassals. There wasn't time to draw more than a small portion of our strength when Halvert made his plea.
And now they march into the teeth of winter,
Jardin muttered.
Better to have waited until spring, or at least tried to negotiate a peace that would have let them withdraw to Greenhall.
Perhaps they will come no farther than Alvert's border,
Dougal said.
Not if they intend to maintain a force here,
Roard answered.
Right now, their supply line crosses at White Lake and travels through as much forest as it does over roads.
Aye,
Thane said with a smile.
The revolt still stands.
On the road from Greenhall and the Fengate, that castle defended the only true bridge across the Tallow. It was still manned by vassals of House Adair, though word of the heresy had thrown their loyalty into question. For the moment, they had denied passage to the Sudran forces determined to lay siege to the gate.
Any battle there will be bloody.
Unless they surrender out of faith to the Church and to keep the Inquisition from laying Adair's sins at their feet,
Dougal said glumly.
They've been true to their watch so far,
Malcolm said.
Let's not doubt them just yet, nor seek out reasons for them to die either.
What do you mean by that?
Castian asked.
Simply that we must decide what to do with the Fengate. Not tonight, not immediately, but soon.
Malcolm did a slow march around the room.
Stormwatch is right. There are deep grudges on both sides of this fight. They are going to be difficult to untangle, and bloody as well. Worse, the fate of this castle itself must be known.
He paused, letting the idea sink in.
House Adair is destroyed. Only Lady Gwendolyn remains, and she will not be sitting the Sedgwin throne any time soon, if she's ever found. The barony may pass to another of Adair's kith,
he continued,
but who among them will be trusted by Sudra? Or their fellow Tenerans, for that matter? Who among us doubted Colm's faith and the faith of his family? And yet here we stand, in the wreckage of his heresy.
Would you claim this holding for your own, Malcolm?
Uwen Thane asked guardedly.
Not that I have any problem with that, but there will be other claims.
No, I would not. Even if Tenere wanted to give it to me, there is too much trouble in the Fen. Trouble I don't want,
Malcolm replied.
And even if I did claim it, would the people of the Fen accept me? Can they be trusted? How broad was Adair's sin? How many witches make their homes in Fenton, or the forests beyond?
We can't very well put the entire holding on trial,
Mayheron muttered.
Putting a good Tenerran lord on the Sedgewind throne would do much to ease my mind, though I think the claims of Finan or Maegallan might carry more weight.
Where are Finan and Maegallan?
Dougal asked.
when Lady Blakeley called for banners, did they come? If this matter isn't going to be settled by inheritance, then shouldn't it be won in battle? Of all the dukes I see in this room, I am the only baron who would benefit from the holding.
And so it begins,
Sir Gast said sharply.
The cake topples from the table, and all the dogs come running.
Who the fuck are you, anyway?
Dougal snapped.
I don't remember asking a servant's opinion on the matter.
My lord died holding this border,
Gast answered smoothly.
I will not see it handed over to the first baron who chooses to speak up.
We're not handing anything over to anyone,
Malcolm said quickly.
And keep in mind, this is no boon. Anyone who holds these walls will suffer the endless attention of the Inquisition and the mistrust of all Sudra. Greenhall isn't going to become a friendly hearth simply because Gabriel Halvert is dead.
If anything, Lady Sophie is going to want that death atoned,
Castian said.
Though gods know whether she will seek payment from the Church or from the North.
Perhaps the Church could assume command of the castle,
Roard suggested.
See the walls made holy and the border calm.
At that, the entire room tensed up. Mayheron and Gast spat dismissively, while Dougal laughed. Even Jardin covered his face with a weary hand.
That may have worked when you had a king who needed usurping, and the Church was the best answer,
Malcolm said.
But it will never be tolerated in the North, not even in a holding as troubled as the Fen.
He shook his head.
Teneran blood for Teneran thrones.
And look how well that has worked, Roard snapped. You can't turn a tribe into a great house just by giving it a name and a motto. Nobility does not sit well on the shoulders of savage men.
At that, the blades came out. Mayheron first, then Gast and Dougal, and finally Malcolm, if only to keep the peace. Castian Jardin backed away from the altar, drawing his sword reluctantly. Roard only laughed.
You would butcher a Sudran duke who chooses to join your cause?
He said.
Fine, then spill my blood, and see what becomes of that army that is marching to your door.
Roard stood abruptly.
Malcolm, I have had enough of this discussion. I will stand at your side because of our friendship, and because Sacombra's war was built on lies and fear. Yet you can't solve this with threats. Send word to the Circle of Lords. Sue for peace. Or find your help in the Church. But I don't think you want the kind of war that Hartsbridge can wage.
No, my friend, I don't,
Malcolm agreed.
And neither do you.
Roard stood stiffly for a minute, then sighed and collapsed into his chair.
Fatigue sharpens my tongue, but not my mind, he said. Forgive me, gentlemen. I misspoke.
There was silence, finally broken by the rasp of swords returning to sheaths. Malcolm was about to continue when the door opened. Sir Caris Dune entered the room. She was dressed for war, as she had been every day since the Fengate fell. She nodded around the room, then turned to Malcolm.
Lord Blakeley?
She asked, then motioned toward the door.
The Inquisitor is here.
Chapter 6. The wide, muddy track the Sudran army had ground into the earth ran from the Fengate straight south. It overlapped the road, stripping the forest bare on either side for half a mile. Frere Lucas and his escort followed this devastation until the road turned southeast toward the Reeveholt. The army's path continued south, crossing open fields and ruined brush like a scar. In retreat, the elements of the Sudran forces that had fled from the attack of the Fengod had followed the same path in reverse. There were signs of their predation in ruined wagons and burned homesteads all the way to the horizon. Lucas paused at the intersection of the two trails. Sir Torvald, his constant companion and frequently miserable host since their departure from the Fengate, rode up next to him. The clatter of wagons followed behind.
"The road or the ruin?"
Lucas muttered.
"Neither an inviting choice. There will be no food south. The army has seen to that,"
Sir Torvald said. The big knight sat awkwardly on a dray that was much too small for his bulk, his own horse having died during the siege of the Fengate.
"We lost a lot of supply wagons to pagan raiders as we came north. We had to forage our meals.
And had to burn down the farms while you were at it, just to be thorough,"
Lucas said.
"It was war,"
Torvald answered.
"Yes, yes. There's no better word for it. War,"
Lucas said. He looked mournfully across the horizon, holding back a sigh.
"We will keep to the road."
"Beg pardon, Frere, but is that wise? The Reeveholt is still in Tenarin hands. Adair hands, if you believe the stories. One of his heretic knights is still holed up behind those walls, succoring gods know how many witches."
"Then it's best we follow that path, speak to these witches, and see their justice done,"
Lucas said. Torvald perked up at that, forcing the Frere to shake his head.
"We are not bringing war to the Reeveholt, Sir Torvald. We escort the wounded and condemned, not to mention the heretic Thomas Sacombra. Our business is for the church, and the church's writ will be honored, even at the Reeveholt."
"They will not let us pass easily,"
Torvald answered.
"Not if we come to them with sword and fire, no,"
Lucas said. He looked back at the tangled column that followed them. Wagons full of the infirm, spottily guarded by Sudran knights, many of them nursing wounds even as they patrolled. They were a sorry lot, those too broken by the gods at the Fengate to face battle, or overwhelmed by the betrayal of the High Inquisitor, in whom they had placed their trust. This was not a fighting force. It was a rout, of the spirit, if not the body. And somehow, Lucas had ended up in charge of it. At the center of the column sat an iron wagon, barred and guarded. It held two prisoners, the witch, Fianna, handed over by Malcolm Blakeley in the wake of the battle at the Fengate, and former High Inquisitor Thomas Sacombra. There was the source of Frere Lucas's authority, and his greatest burden. For he was the man charged with bringing the High Inquisitor to trial, to justice, and probably to death. The column followed his word out of some kind of awe or fear, or just sympathy. A familiar figure rode beside the wagon, dressed in the bright red of his house. Facing Lucas, Martin Roard raised an arm in salute. The boy had insisted on following the caravan south, leaving his father to treat with Malcolm Blakeley back at the Fengate. Lucas suspected he was ashamed at having betrayed his lifelong friend, Ian Blakeley, or perhaps intended to set his honor right by seeing Sacombra brought to justice. Lucas turned back to the cross-country scar.
The men and women who fled along this route will be desperate. They are far from home, stranded in the pagan north with its feral gods and blood-hungry raiders. They burned any possible shelter on their way up, so we can't imagine them seeing much hospitality from those they left behind,
Lucas said.
We cannot count on their loyalty. They will be more interested in their safety than our duty.
Isn't it our duty to see them safely home?
Torvald said.
They are Sudran brothers, after all.
The big knight sat slumped in his saddle, the wispy ends of his mustache drooping nearly to his elbows.
Some questions have a spiritual answer. Questions of duty and faith and honor,
Lucas responded, turning to Torvald, then back to the ruin to their south.
Others, however, have a practical answer. We don't have the food to spare, sir. If we follow that path, we will starve before we reach Greenhall.
And if the guardians of the Reaveholt refuse us?
Torvald asked.
They will not,
Lucas answered, and hoped it was true. The walls of the Reaveholt were ancient and strong. The bluffs along the Tallow were steep, the river a roaring whitewater that couldn't be crossed. The castle perched like a hawk on the river's edge, overlooking the Holtspan, the great bridge that joined north and south. Halvert's army had bypassed this stronghold out of desperation and zealous speed, instead crossing at the fords at White Lake, following the route of Malcolm's army. Even if the siege of the Fengate had continued, the garrison here would have proven an insurmountable thorn in the side of the Sudran army. Lucas ordered the colors stowed, all save the black and gold banner of the church and the white flag of peace. High Elector Bonaire had ridden under the church's banner. His body was among the wagons, along with Duke Halvert and the rest of the honored dead, those noble or wealthy enough to justify carrying home for burial. They formed into columns to emphasize the thinness of their ranks and let the wagons of dead and wounded wind down the road. Frere Lucas rode at the head, with Torvald and the few Sudran lords who accompanied them. Only Duke Laguerre rode in full regalia. His armor shined, and his lance hung with favors of the Inquisition. Martin Roard left his distinctive copper armor in the wagons, opting for simple linen and a tabard of red and yellow. The young man looked out of place among the grizzled knights who followed close behind. That lot was armed and armored, but their numbers weren't enough to pose a true threat to the castle. The defenders watched from the walls. The only banner to fly from the towers was that of Sir Bourne, a red water wheel with a leaping fish above, all on a field of black.
At least he has struck Adair's colors,
Lucas said.
That's a positive sign.
As Adair struck his pagan colors following the crusade, and we can all see where that led,
Laguerre muttered. There was a murmur of agreement among the knights, but it died as soon as Lucas turned to face them. The Duke of Warholme shrugged.
We must judge our enemies by their actions, Frere,
he persisted defensively.
I have seen enough Teneran betrayal to fill a tome. I will not soon forget that. What of Sicombra?
Lucas countered.
Was his betrayal any less? And that while wearing the colors of the Inquisition. I am wearing an Inquisitor's robe, and answer to the Inquisitor's title. Do you suspect me of the same heresy, Warholm? That would be a dangerous game, Frere,
Laguerre answered.
Besides, without Sicombra, we would never have uncovered Adair's heresy. Perhaps he led us true, despite his failing.
That is for Hartsbridge to decide,
one of the knights said quickly. She wore Fabron's colors, but with a crest of circled antlers on her breast. Lucas remembered her from the last Frost Knight tournament he had spent in the South, 5 seasons past. She had been an ace in the Gentleblade tournament. He was surprised to find her in an army of invasion. Her name was Chloe Horn, if his memory served.
Yes, Martin Roard agreed. We must not allow the faithful of Sudra to doubt the High Inquisitor's sins. Malcolm Blakeley was very insistent on that point.
Is Malcolm Blakeley your lord?
Laguerre asked.
Or do you act in the interest of Stormwatch, as your father commanded?
The needs of Stormwatch and the needs of Hound Hallow are often joined, Martin said shortly.
A round of mocking laughter went through the knights, starting and ending with Laguerre's sneering face. Martin remained unswayed. Sir Horn stepped to his aid.
It is best to judge before we act, she said. Isn't that what Cinder teaches us?
A battlefield does not allow such luxury,
Laguerre said.
We are not here to do battle, my lord,
Horn answered.
Else we would be flying the flag of peace dishonestly.
No,
Lucas said.
We are not. Warholm, you stay here. If Sir Born decides to cut us down in a hail of arrows, you have my blessing to wage whatever battle you see fit. Sir Torvald, Sir Roard, Sir Horn, if the three of you would come with me.
Lucas turned to face the closed gate of the Reaveholt.
Let us see what sort of peace we can find.
The approach to the Reaveholt was stone that extended in all directions from the gate. The bluffs were freshly scraped of moss and grass, leaving only rock underfoot as Lucas and his two companions rode forward. Fresh scars marked the ground. Sir Horn peered down at them as they passed.
What are these?
She asked.
Scars struck by iron arrowheads,
Lucas said.
Bodkins, probably. They'll be saving the broad tips for us if this goes poorly.
They have been practicing their ranges, sir,
Torvald said quietly,
in anticipation of our visit.
Ah,
Horn answered, as understanding dawned on her. And then a moment later, and a little more quietly,
ah.
Let us hope their judgment matches their preparation,
Martin muttered. There were no archers to be seen on the walls, but that meant little. A single spotter from the tower could direct flights from the courtyard, as long as the bowmen were trained and the distances known. Lucas could feel the sweat pouring down his back in spite of the early autumn chill. He tried not to flinch when a flock of sparrows leapt from the gatehouse tower. It was all he could do to keep his eyes forward and his reins steady. The horses sensed their rider's tension, speeding up slightly in an effort to close the distance. Lucas kept them at an even trot. The gate creaked open, and three riders came out. Like Duke Laguerre, they were dressed in full regalia, horses caparisoned in the colors of the House of Sir Born, lances and shields at the parade ready. Horn and Torvald drew close to Lucas's flanks, their knees nearly touching, with Martin a bit behind. Lucas cleared his throat.
This is not a charge, sirs. No need to close ranks just yet.
They know what we're about,
Torvald said.
Those three aren't here to talk peace.
Then it will be a short conversation. One you should leave to me, sir,
Lucas said.
I don't want to risk a fight.
Sir Born himself wasn't among the three who rode out to meet them. All three had the look of professional men-at-arms, soldiers sworn to their house at birth, accustomed to the blade. Apart from their dark hair and the tattoos that crawled across their brows, these men were indistinguishable from Sudren soldiers, with their plate and half, heraldry, and saddles.
Bleach their hair and clean their faces, and these three could grace the court of any southern lord,
Lucas thought. The three Tenarans stopped as he and his companions approached, until the distance between them was close enough for swords.
The things we fight over are so little,
Lucas muttered.
So little?
The lead Tenaran spat.
Would you call the pillage of the fen so little? Would you call the rape of our land and the murder of our lord so little?
My apologies,
Lucas said quickly.
I was just musing on our differences and our likenesses. There is more that binds us together than separates us, especially in faith.
We put our faith in the church and see what that got us,
the man answered.
A Sudren army ranging our homelands, and the old of our lord toppled by Sudren treachery. Have you finally decided to come south and deal with our little nuisance of a castle?
Peace, peace,
Lucas said.
The army of the south has splintered, and their will to fight has broken.
Don't let Laguerre hear you say that,
Sir Horn muttered with a glance over her shoulder.
No matter,
the Tenaran said.
Sudren bandits roam the countryside, and banners of the south remain at the fen gate. Now you come to revolt in force, no doubt to secure the path for your inevitable and cowardly retreat.
Does this look like a column of war to you?
Lucas asked, the exasperation plain in his voice.
We carry the dead and dying, along with those who have seen through Sacombra's deception and given up the fight. We have no grudge with you, and would not seek one.
If it was Sacombra's lie that started this war, why does a priest of the Inquisition lead this force?
The man asked.
Of all the things that binds us together, north and south, it is the celestial faith that is the strongest. Have you renounced your loyalty to Cinder as well as strife?
Lucas asked. The Tenaran seemed startled by this, but before he could answer, the Frere plowed forward.
If the charges against Sacombra are true, and he committed heresy in provoking this war, who is better equipped to negotiate the peace than the Inquisition? The same goes for Colm Adair. Would you rather all Tenair bear the weight of his sin? Or do you trust the Inquisition to shrive right from wrong, and guilt from innocence?
The stories about the bearing up,
the man began. Lucas interrupted at the top of his lungs.
I have stood in the Witch's Hollow,
he shouted,
and witnessed the pagan rites to which Colm Adair was loyal. I have faced the demon summoned by Thomas Sacombra,
and hunted the heretics that the High Inquisitor corrupted with his lies. My brother priests!
He drew himself up.
You do not tell me about the stories, sir. I have faced the pagan, and the heretic, and the monster. And Cinder is my judge. I will see them brought to justice if it's with my last breath.
This silenced the Tenarans. The men fidgeted on their horses, looking from the walls to the column of Sudran refugees.
You hunt Thomas Secumbra?
The leader said eventually.
Because I swear by sun and summer that he has not passed this way. No,
Lucas said with a grim smile.
He has not. Yet.
Chapter 7. Ian's foot left the branch of the nightmare tree. The mists swirled around his face, the forest disappearing behind him as though he was flying straight up into a cloudy sky. He breached the wall of clouds and spiraled into an expanse of blinking stars. The strange man appeared before him, hunched forward on a promontory of rock that cut into the fog like the prow of a ship. A wide spit of land lurked just beneath the cloud bank, a dark form. Forms? Masked by the gloom. Ian hung there like a leaf caught in the wind. The man, his bright eyes hazed in shadow, twitched upright. This time, Ian's gaze remained steady on them.
You have not yet found your way home. I thought your tame Don would be escort enough.
He waved a palsied hand at Ian's hovering form, dropping him from the sky. The ground slapped into Ian's feet as he fell.
You cannot stay here much longer, either of you.
We'd be happy to leave, Father Knight, Ian said.
The Geist shivered at the words, a slow smile that cracked the skin of his lips.
Father Knight,
he chuckled.
Such an easy title, and so quiet. Call me by other names, son of hounds. I am the child of death, the little winter. Every day's reminder of the end of life itself.
My father always says the night is nothing more than the home of lies and dishonest men. A place for treachery, for banditry, for behavior unworthy of honorable men. Darkness must be suffered if we are to appreciate the light.
Your father says this?
The Geist asked, straightening his back, revealing unexpected height. His gaunt frame rose high above Ian.
Your father will die. Let's weigh the value of his words when they come from the grave.
You shouldn't be so haughty, Ian said, drawing himself up. God's end as well, just like the night. And winter.
You have a twisted view of the world, child,
the Geist answered.
There is no end to the night. Not even dawn can break us. The rising sun is only the promise of another nightfall. A child is born for no reason other than to die.
The Geist waved a twisted, dismissive hand in Ian's direction and started to turn away.
I have no time for this.
Gods die, Ian insisted, at the hands of mortal men and women and children.
He reached out, palms up, smiling. at my hands. The Geist paused, glancing over his shoulder with a sneer.
A tiny threat from a tiny man,
the Geist said.
Leave me.
That is not how this works, Ian snapped. We are not free to come and go. You've seen to that with your nightmares and your maze of trees. Elsa would cut her way free if she could, and she is not a woman accustomed to being rescued. We cannot leave you. No. Ian shook his head, drawing his fists even with his waist. You must leave us.
Oh? And how will this be accomplished?
The Geist turned and lurched closer.
How will you expel me from my own realm, Ian of Hounds? You have no blood-wrought blade. You know nothing of the rites of my Theos.
Closer, the Geist's face grew calm. His smile faded, and the cracked ruin of his lips formed a jagged line.
There is nothing you can do to me, child.
Does your brother know you are stealing from him? Ian asked. The Geist paused and became very still.
My brother?
Now you forget? You are the shadow of death, that darkest of gods, and yet you try to claim what is rightfully his.
I know not what you are talking about,
the Geist said, too quickly, backing away, then turning.
Return to your companion,
he said over his shoulder.
Take what comfort you can in her light before it snuffs out.
I will, Ian said, once we are free. He looked around the spit of land on which they stood, and pointed to the shadows that lurked just beneath the fog. Did you think I wouldn't see these? Do you think the god of death won't miss them?
Begone!
The Geist snapped. The rolling sea of fog swelled up to Ian's knees, the chill of it leaking through his breeches, hiding the shadows in its murk.
I take only what comes to me. I have been gentle on you so far. The realm of dream has sharper horrors than this.
Death counts its cost, Ian returned, gathering the mist closer. The memory of Fianna came to him, the power she exerted to carry her fellow druids on wings of fog back when they were traveling the Fen. No man escapes it, no woman, no child. Not even these few.
You have the witch's touch to you, child. I did not sense it at first, but now. What are you trying to do now?
Just clearing the air a bit, Ian said. He pushed outward with his heart, snagging the blanket of fog like a net and throwing it away from him. The murk disappeared with a breath, leaving only rough stone underfoot. There were bodies all around, their wasted limbs as tangled as driftwood after the flood has receded. They wore Tiber black, the crescent and hand worked into their shields and the pommels of their broken swords. Their skin was stretched thin and gray, but none of them had any obvious wounds. Death will count his debt and find these souls missing, Ian said. And then what will you do?
That is none of your business,
the Geist replied.
My brother has slipped in his duties, and these few lingered in my realm, and so I thought, I hoped.
The strange man rubbed willow-thin hands together.
There should be more to my home than passing guests. I deserve more than that. He is younger, after all. Younger and greedier, and so damned full of himself.
Keeping these souls is not your domain, knight. And if you will not bow to the old god, you must submit to another, Ian said. He bent to the nearest corpse, rolling its head on the stone. I am no priest, but I know Cinder's rights as well as anyone.
No, you can't!
The Geist cried out.
You don't understand what you're doing!
Before it could interrupt, however, Ian sketched the icon of the crescent moon on the man's forehead, muttering the prayers of severing that would free the dead to return to the quiet. He wasn't sure he was doing it right, but he had seen the ritual often enough in his days at war. For extra measure, he added in a little of the prayers spoken by Call whenever one of the druids died. Ian was just finishing when the Geist's bony hand gripped his shoulder and shoved him aside.
If he hears that call, you'll ruin everything,
it whispered harshly.
I've worked too hard.
But it was too late. The dead man changed, and the world with him. A thin web of dark ink crept from the traditional tattoos on the body's face. It bled down his cheeks, limning his teeth in shadow and oil. The Geist flinched back, as though the body was on fire. The nearby waves of fog grew sharp, grays bleaching white, shadows diving into absolute blackness.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.